But I'm calling you onto a bigger mothering. Are we together? God is calling you into a larger concept of mothering. Mothers of a nation. Mothers of what? Of a nation. Mothers in Israel. He said, I arose a mother in Israel. Then there was another mother. This mama, she was a convert from idol worship and she has suffered persecution in the community. She was a grandmother to my bosom friend we used to go to school. And when she knew that I've repented and I'm facing persecution at home, this old mama will just call us. And every day, every morning, as we are going to school, we are going to grammar school and we are going to trek about 5 kilometers. Before we move, Mama will gather us around her knees because she cannot walk again. She said, yeah, come, come. And then she will put her 2 hands, one on me, one on her grandson that was my friend. And this, anytime you are late for school, don't go near Mama. Because when she begins to pray like this, 15 minutes will pass. You will not know. She has not started. You see, you know, as young people, we did not even appreciate because Mama's prayer was too long. She would take every issue, every item in our lives. She's telling God about it. I never dreamt of marrying when that old mama began to talk to God and say, Oluwa, majeki won gbe egun ele egun. That's the prayer in Yoruba language. Don't let these boys, don't let them pick another person's bone. I didn't know that there is something called bone of my bones. I didn't know anything like that. So if you see me that I've married a wife that has been useful to me and to all of you, it is that grandmother. This was investment of prayer. Can I tell you, I was under that ministry of praying morning, afternoon for 5 years. I was a day student going every day. When we go in the morning, she prays. When we are coming back, as soon as we drop our bag, she said, yeah, come, 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 come. She will gather us again and begin again and say, God, I don't know what these boys faced when they were going, but thank you that you have brought them back. Another round of prayer on my head. You think I will be a useless man? I have collected too much prayer. Prayer of mothers. Hallelujah. And when I grew out of that, and I began to see the call of God on my life, one day I was again totally dejected. And I say, what am I living for? What am I doing again? And I remember one day I just put my hand on my head and I was looking in the sky. I said, God, my own is finished. And I didn't know that right in the meeting, in the fellowship, God went and told one sister, say, and call her by name, say, look, you see you, whatever you are doing, stop it. Run after this brother. And I want you now, that's your ministry now, to do nothing again. But to be praying for him. Withdraw from every activity group and concentrate prayer on this brother. I've never understood why God so loved me that he planted on my path mothers. when she has come out of that kind of travail, she said, Brother Agbile, you will not fail. God is going to help you. Then she will start prophesying. Me, I will just carry my Bible, I will be writing. I'll be collecting prophecy, collecting prophecy, collecting prophecy. And when it was time, God said, I'll give you a wife, but it will be your mother. You need another mother for a wife. I call my wife mommy today, not because of her babies. It's because she's the one who continued the ministry of mothers. You need to see her traveling over my head. You need to see her groaning as if I was hanging in between the umbilical cord that need to be pushed. I said, what is this now? He said, just go. You can go. For many years, you never see my wife in a meeting like this. She's inside somewhere there. Because I said, Lord, what is it? Until there will arise mothers, not murderers. Not murderers. Unfortunately, the picture the devil has painted about women is that women are murderers. That they are the people that will kill a man of God. That they are people that will slaughter men of God. I say, no. Maybe some of you have met such women. But the women that God has allowed me to meet in my own life, they are not murderers. What are they? Their mothers. They gave up their convenience to see their sons become something. Do you understand what I'm talking about? God is asking us to raise mothers for Nigeria. Mothers for Plateau State. Mothers for Adamawa State. Mothers for Ondo State. Mothers for Benue State. Mothers. 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 They don't discriminate. The concern in their heart is that this our baby must not be wasted. How many of you know that great mothers don't eat much? Let me ask you, do you know that at all? Eh? Please talk to me. Real mothers, they don't eat, oh, they don't eat much. I have discovered that when we were growing up and there is food and the meat was not enough, and this is the meat that mama was to eat, do you know what she did? She used her teeth to cut it. Eh? And brought it out. I said, this is your own. This is your own. I said, mama, what are you going to eat your own? He said, the meat didn't go ready, General. But she had teeth to cut the meat. How can she say she does not have teeth to eat the meat? The care of a mother. A mother will go hungry to make sure that his children are eating. I'm looking for mothers for Nigeria. When they stand behind a government, it's not what to eat. They are not concerned about what to eat.
many of you have gone home to the village to visit your old mother? Let me see your hand up. You still have your mother living in the village. All right. When you go, imagine that you carry something from the city. When you are coming back, what does your mother do? Eh? You will see she will go and get gari, she will get a lubo, she will get whatever she can get. The little yam she has, she's packing everything. Say, you go. And the food you carry home to give her, are you hearing me? Your mother will say, it's okay. There are some other people that if you don't give this thing, they will not let you live long. I will distribute it for them in your name. So what did your mother begin to do now? She will carry it inside. Hey, this your son that came back from Abuja. He said, I should give you this. So the bag of salt you brought home, did you notice that mama only used it for PR for you? What do I call PR? Public relation. So as you are coming by the next time, you see all the women in the village, they are coming to greet. Esho, thank you. We got the salt, you say. You say, when did I give them salt? You don't know the ministry of a mother. God is saying, this confusion will continue in Nigeria until I arouse a mother. One of the reasons why this Christian ladies retreat is critical is that God is calling for all mothers. Not just mothers of their babies, not just mothers of their small children, not just mothers that are concerned about their sons. We are looking for mothers in Israel. Mothers. Can I tell you the truth is this? This phenomenon I'm dealing with this morning, the devil also understands it. Are you hearing me? The devil also works very mightily with it. So you will see that once people begin to get into political power, the next thing they are also looking for. What are they looking for? They are looking for mothers. I want yaje, witches, oshorongas. They don't come out in the afternoon. You see them sitting down there looking like this. They say, yeah, go. We are behind you. The devil knows the power of motherhood. So if he captures a woman and gives her a wrong assignment, but I want to inform you, such useless demonic mothers over Nigeria, God is going to wipe them off in the name of Jesus Christ. But you know why God has not done so? There can be no vacuum in nature. You are not hearing me very well, though. Do you know that there are many of our governors, many of them, they are looking for mothers. You see them going into small ghettos. Who are they going to meet there? There's one old woman. The affairs of Nigeria sometimes are ruled by illiterate women who have dedicated themselves to demons. You see them eating, they are just chewing. What are they chewing? They are chewing maybe kola nut and alligator pepper. And immediately people are made commissioners, they are made governors, they are made something. You see them running there. God wants to replace that. So why are we calling you here? That God might raise women professing godliness
as mothers. The qualification of these women that are mothers for Nigeria are that they pray regardless of political affiliation. One of the things I know about a mother is that no matter how the children are opposing themselves, have you ever seen a mother that will not be neutral among his children? Eh? You will notice that no matter where they are going, the mother will say, well, as I deliver you, that's how I deliver him. When mama wants you to settle a quarrel between your brothers, you know what she does? Old women, she will just bring her two breasts and bring it out. I say, now, can you fight? As you suck this, you sucked. These two breasts is what the two of you suck. How can you? You want to kill me? If you don't want me to die, go and settle your quarrel. Am I right? Now, it is lack of mothers in our nation that is making so many of our brothers to sell out our heritage simply because they are fighting themselves. I'm sitting here and I'm seeing how a little political rivalry will make our sons to sell out our heritage. I have been saying, oh God, when will you give me space to call these boys together and say, why are you doing this? But you know, I couldn't. Only mothers that can bring out their breasts will speak and issues will be resolved. So mama was telling me a story yesterday. I was overwhelmed. You remember she said, God was telling her, call all these people from Plateau. Call all of them. All of them. Regardless of whatever party, call them. Mama, did they come? They came. She stood up as the Lord gave utterance. And all of them said, Mama, Mama, what you have said we will do. People that will not greet themselves before, because Mama brought her two breasts. Because almost all of them, they all grew from her nurturing. Can we pray that God will raise mothers in Nigeria? Eh? Mothers. Mothers that are neutral enough. Mothers whose prayers transcend what you can give me to eat. Mothers. Honestly speaking, I'm asking God to do that before you leave here. I'm asking that God will anoint you with the anointing of mothers. That I will be able to present to God and say, Father, now, there are women with womb. There are mothers with hearts. What are you waiting for? When are you going to stop this confusion over this nation? When are you going to bring this matter to a stop? I want all of you to agree with me as we will be praying in this meeting that you will not only hear, because God will give you long life, you will see a new Nigeria born. We will see the rebirth of our nation. I'm looking for mothers whose hearts are large enough, and first ladies that are here, thank God for bringing you here. I hope you will remember that why you should stand behind your husband as their wives.
I want you to know that there's another role that God is asking you to play over the affairs of the state where your husband is now governor, is to be a mother of that land. Be a mother. Enlarge your heart. All those people in the land, they are your children. They will be your children in the name of Jesus Christ. Enlarge your heart and say, God, in the place of prayer, I'm going to see this state turn around. You know, there are many, many things that are going on. You know, sometimes people are going for, and I know it. You know where I grew from, I know what I'm talking about. I know that sometimes your husband has made a decision, that when we get to the meeting, this is what I'm going to say, this is what I'm going to do. Then one has already come from Mama Yajek. They have gone to some mothers, evil mothers. They say, when you get into the chambers, where does the governor normally sit? If he sits here, go and sit directly opposite him and be looking at him. As you are looking at him, when your two eyes are meeting, he will stammer. He will forget what he wanted to say. Go. Evil mothers. So your husband that you have talked with, you have agreed that this is what we are going to do, he gets to the place. Suddenly, instead of him to speak clearly, you say, an intelligent man has become a stammerer. Who will counteract such evil mothers? It is you. Those who stand and say, Father, even as he's going there, release utterance to him. Give him wisdom that nobody can resist when he finishes speaking. This bill that he needs to present, let nobody be able to argue against it in the name of Jesus Christ, because this is your will. Can I find out again? Who among you this afternoon are saying, Lord, if there is an anointing to be a mother in Israel, I want it. Let me see your hand up. Lord, I want it. Lord, I want it. Make me a mother of a nation. God will do it in the name of Jesus Christ. What is the number three reason why God is turning attention to the ladies? What is it that God wanted? And I want you to see it very quickly here. In Judges chapter 5, verse 8 and 9, they chose new gods. Then there was war in the gates. There was not a shield or spear seen among 40,000 in Israel. Can you imagine? Hefty men, big men, they have no weapon to fight. I'm sorry to inform you, some of you think our men are very energetic. The truth of the matter is that there is no spear, no sword in their hands. Many of them, honestly speaking, they are impotent. Many of them can't do more than what they have done. They have been captured at heart. So, what was God looking for? He said, my heart is towards which people? Which people, please? The governors of Israel. Please listen. If you are listening to me, I will be very grateful to God. Do you know, once a man comes into leadership, Once he begins to become governor or commissioner or head of parastata or a vice chancellor, anything that is a little up there that shoots him out. If God does not pull correct women whose hearts are going to God on their behalf, do you know what immediately happens? Satan arranges women around them. Oh Lord, are you not hearing me? Because of the potential of a woman, the devil knows who you are. He knows what God has put in a woman that she can do. When God said, I will make for him a help, Satan knew that, if we want to finish a man, we either finish the woman around him or make the woman the wrong one. Many of you are saying, in many men of God, they are falling. Women have brought them down. Many governors, if you know the pressure many of our husbands that are entering to leadership, what they enter into with women, who send them texts, who come around, who dress tersely, who bring some special soup, and if they are moving like this, say, I saw you. They have a special smile to give him and his head will turn. Many of state affairs are discussed at pepper soup joints. When you meet some young girls and they say, well, we will deal with him, we will deal with him. Don't take that girl for granted though. They know what they are talking about. They have capacity to finish governors. Many governors are confused because there are some group of women, charlatans, that are controlling their lives. I went somewhere to preach some years ago, and a woman was arrested by the word of God as I finished preaching. And she came to me under conviction and said, sir, you have touched my life and I want to repent. So I sat back, I said, what is it? She asked me two questions that I couldn't answer immediately. She said, look at me very well. How old do you think I am? This is a woman asking me. I said, I wouldn't know, but you look like 24. He said, yes, you guessed right. I am 48. But I deliberately prepare myself to look like 24. There is no man I cannot finish. So I finished many. I use my body to collect contracts. No man has ever said no to me. Then she stood up in my presence. She said, you see, if I enter an office, I carry an aura that overcomes everybody there. But as you were preaching, I am meeting a man that doesn't seem to care about how I look. The question you were asking, he said, how is your heart? You pierce me. You pierce me. You pierce me. Then she broke down. She's crying. I said, so what do you want to do? And I said, I don't know where to start. I have deceived my husband. I have cheated this, I've cheated this, I've cheated this. Boys that I carry about as my boyfriend, they were of the age of my child. But they think I'm a small girl. As you see me dressed like this, I dress tightly so that my body doesn't loose. You know, I was listening, you know, the peri of a preacher. You hear all kind of things. As I was listening to her, I say, ah! I said, this is one that has ruined many. Father, we must snatch her from the gall of Satan. We prayed. She was showing great interest in the word of God. But what could I do? I'm leaving that environment for 3 days now. When I told her that this meeting will finish, she said, you mean you are going to leave? I said, but there are men of God here that can help me. Say, which one? Say, which one? I said, this reverend, is that one. The one that invited you to come and preach. Is that one you are talking about? We know ourselves. I said, what of this one? Say, which one? They are all my boys. I told you that you pierced my heart. You pierced my heart. I said to her, madam, I don't know what to do. I'm going. I have to go. I have somewhere else to go and preach. I prayed and prayed and said, God, raise men that are unconquerable by women. So now, what do we need? Because I'm telling you, God is asking me to talk to you very, very critically. You are going to take a decision before we leave here. Because man, are you hearing me? Man, men, they are needing help. I'm talking to you, are you hearing me? Every man, he is completely helpless. He needs help. And the best person that could be a help to his life is first and foremost his wife. And if not his wife, it must be a woman whose heart is correct. Are we together? Because of this helplessness that men found themselves in, Satan tries to exploit it by pushing all kind of women. All kind of women. Some of you that your husbands are in government, you already know what I'm talking about. You know that it's a battle again not to lose your husband to strange women. Is a battle on its own. Yet they need women whose hearts are towards the governors to help them. And God is saying, can you labor to raise such godly women? So you see, this meeting is not a casual meeting at all. We are not doing something because it's an annual event. No, we don't do such things here. If God has no agenda, there's nothing. I don't do such things because what do I gain? Sisters, let me ask you, what do I gain? Eh? Nothing. If you don't rise to become correct, we have wasted our own life. Please listen. God is saying, can you raise women whose hearts are not like that of Jezebel, but like that of Deborah, whose hearts are towards the governors, towards the leaders, towards the men and women in government, those that are in offices, principals, vice chancellors, that can help them? That can help them and give them a clear insight That's where I'm coming. We need women whose hearts are towards leaders. First to pray. If I tell you one secret, because you're already women, you know it. Can I tell you? Do you know that by nature, God makes you as a woman meticulous? Do you know that by your nature, a woman is concerned about details? Details. By nature, man is only concerned about blocks. Your husband is thinking about big things. He doesn't think about details. There are so many loopholes and gaps in the life of a man. It is not his fault. That is how he was made. Only women are raised to bring details to fill up the gaps. There are many, many decisions that a man will make. He has made his decision, but he has not thought of the details. He has not thought about the nitty-gritty of how it will come to pass. It's only the woman that comes in and says, yes, you have said that. But this had to be brought in before that can happen. Only a woman sees that. But now, if God will not raise women who are meticulous, who have details of insight, of revelation, of understanding to fill up the gaps. You know that sometimes your husband wants to associate with a political alliance, but because he doesn't see details, he can't see what will be the implication. Many times he has already made a public announcement before the reality of what he said will dawn on him. He said, oh, but I didn't think about that. Have you heard husband say that kind of thing before? As your husband invited 5 people to lunch in your house without telling you, he has already told them to arrive, and they have already arrived. To him, he only sees that these people should eat. He doesn't remember that in between the raw food and the table set, there are details. Cannot remember. Sometimes he forgets that he has given appointment to somebody to come at 3. There's an important meeting he wants to have at 3. Are you understanding? Then he looks and says, okay, you can come at 2:30. Why did he do that? He does not remember details. Doesn't remember that somebody coming at 2:30, the pleasantries of greetings and say, how are you, how are the children and all of that, before he settles down, before he begins to talk at all, 3:00 has arrived. So you see him pressed. You see people pressing him. He has not eaten. He has not slept. He has not gone out. Why is he like that? He doesn't understand details. You do. If you want to live long, if a man wants to live long, he must allow his wife to organize him. I'm sorry. Please, don't go and tell your husband at home so that they will not say, what is he saying? But that's the truth. That is the truth. When they are here, when your husbands are here, I will tell them. If you go and tell them, they may say, what do you mean? You mean I don't know what to do something? Don't tell them. Wait, I will tell them by myself. God will give me opportunity. Family finance. When you see a husband struggling to handle family finance, he's going to enter into trouble. He doesn't understand what to do. Because he can't see details. He will have committed himself and said, we are going to give you so much money. Before he will remember that, oh, there's this. It is the word that said, ah, when you said this, do you remember this one? It's, oh, so it is actually this man that we are going, hey. Oh, so what do I do now? And I've told the man, that's why they become liars. God must raise for us. I want to inform you, even though it's so dangerous, the best people to organize a man's itinerary, the best person to be confidential secretary, the best person to handle a man's nitty-gritty of, oh, you promised this person this, you need to do this, you have not done this, you need to go here, you said this, it's a woman. But usually, when such women are now instruments of Satan, you know the man is finished. Eh? Can we pray? Raise women whose hearts are towards the governors, the leaders, the principal officers, the directors, so that they can do well. Nigeria is in need, in dire need of correct women. The discipleship that God is asking us to do among women is not purposeless. Are you hearing me? The discipleship in churches, in women fellowship, is not purposeless. It's to raise women that can fill the gap, that can help men with details. While we are sluggish, Satan is quickly filling up the place with his own ladies. I almost can inform you that several of our governors, the reason why they are weak is because they have found themselves in the hand of wrong people, wrong counselors, and when their women finished, they put too much trouble on their path. So God is looking for women like Deborah, whose hearts, purely pure hearts, are towards the governors, to help them, to bring them to their places of inheritance. Hallelujah. The next point, I have two more points. After that, you will be praying with me. Just two more points. The next point, women that are not struggling to take over. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is looking for women who understand their position. They know that they are the ones who put a man at the gate among the elders. In your little manner, those of you that are not even big women yet, you are married. Do you know that any time your husband is traveling and you are not at home to pack for him, you know that wherever he goes, there are many, many things he has forgotten. Have you noticed that? Sometimes your husband will have driven out, then you will see one pair of his slippers. He has carried one pair, he has left the second pair at home. You are saying, what will my husband use now? Sometimes you will notice that in the midst of his traveling, he has forgotten his towel. As soon as your husband say, I am traveling, I'm telling you a secret. Do you know what it is? His heart has already arrived at where he is going. How to get there, what we use there, what will he use there, doesn't concern him. As you see, he said, no, we must go now, time has gone. It is only when he arrives there, then he opens his suitcase. He's looking for everything he needed. It's not there. So, because he doesn't know what to do, he will just put his hand and bring out some bundle of money and get some girls. Please go and get me this. And what he could have spent 20 naira on, he will spend 2,000. His life is too expensive without a woman. Wasteful, because a woman is not there to pack for him. Do you know that we need a woman who is not intending to take over the husband's place, but who is there to pack him? I need women that packs their husband, packs for them, position them in the place of honor. Those that they are sitting behind the desk and they are the one pushing the agenda, said this, you have not done this, don't forget this, you need to do this. There is these people that you need to remember. There's this person that you need to talk about. There is this project that you started, let's finish it. I'm praying for you, make sure you finish this. And before you make a promise, tell them that the governor is thinking about it, so that we can have time to plan it out. I need women like that. Whether they are preachers, whether they are politicians, whether they are professionals, whether they are in business, we need women who will push their men to the right place. Look at Deborah, God using her to bring up Barak. The Bible said, she sent and called Barak, verse 6, chapter 4, verse 6, the son of Abinoam out of Kadesh Naphtali, and said to him, has not the Lord God of Israel commanded, saying, go and draw towards Mount Tabor, take with you 10,000 men of the children of Naphtali and of the children of Zebulun. Has God not told you that? And I will draw unto you to the river Kishon, Sisera, the captain of Jabez, with his chariots and his multitude, and I will deliver him into your hand. Has God not said that's what you should do? Barak said to her, madam, if you will go with me, then I will do what? I will go. But if you will not go with me, I can't go anywhere. And the woman said, I will surely go with you. The only reason is that you must be the one going. We will go with you, but you go. Because the journey that you take, if you don't go, it shall not be for your honor. We will go with you, but the Lord will send Sisera into the hand of a woman. But no problem, we will go with you. Can I pray that God will raise women, both in the church, women in the work of God? They are not eager to be on the pulpit, but they are considering, say, this is my husband, this is my man, or these men that God is raising, let's put them where? Let's position them. When God will solve the problem of women in Nigeria now, Nigeria will rise to something and you'll be surprised. So this quiet meeting is happening in small boko like this, in a bush. But mark it. Mark what we are saying. As the Lord lives in heaven, and as the Lord graciously raises women here, And as the Spirit of God will move upon you, me and you, we will live to celebrate a new Nigeria. I am not just dealing with one event. We are dealing with process. God has arisen and said, but this is what you should do now. Begin to train women. Don't leave the women. Don't let the devil avest the women. If the devil avested the women, your men are finished. Your spirituality that you are focusing on men is a waste until the women are ready to make them spiritual. Finally, the last point, strategic women. That's the last reason. And you are going to be praying about that. Now, I've talked about Deborah strategic, but I want you to look at one other woman that you could easily ignore. But as Sister Zainab was speaking, she spoke about a woman with yogurt. In chapter 4, verse 17, the Bible says he fled away on his feet to the tent of Jael. Jael was the wife of Heber, the Canaanite. For there was peace between Jabin, the king of Hazor, and the house of Heber, the Kenite. Now I want you to please note one thing here. It will take me a little time and I will finish it, and you are praying for me and praying with me. The Bible said, this woman Jael is the wife of Heber. Heber was the Kenite. You will know that Kenites, they come from the family of Jethro. Are you hearing me? Jethro actually was the grandfather of Kenites. And you remember that Moses married his daughter. Zipporah was a Kenite. And even though, when you read your Bible very well, you know that the Midianites, they are also the descendants of Abraham from the other woman that he married after Sarah died, Keturah. So one way or the other, you will always find in the Bible that sometime there is a prophet among the Midianites. So somebody like Balaam was a prophet coming out of that family. Jethro was coming out of that kind of family. So, you know, they carry something. Unfortunately, as things developed, Midianites, sometimes they will position themselves against the children of Israel. And look at this lady. She's married to Heber. And her husband, Mr. Heber, was at peace with Jabin, the king of Hazor. And they were against Israel. And Jael knew, said, look, my husband is in alliance with a wrong people. Sisters, do you want me to teach you strategies? There are some times that your husband is in a wrong alliance. Your husband is joining a wrong business now. The political pressure is making him to jump into a wrong camp. And the people he wants to run with now, he really doesn't fit in. You know that your husband is not like that. But when he meets these people, he gets confused. What they are saying just confuses him. He doesn't know where he's going again. What will you do if you are Jael? The Bible said, as Sisera was running now, because God was giving victory to his people, Jael went out in front of the door. And as Sisera was running, She stood there and said, "Ah, you must be tired now." Sisera said, "Yes, I'm more than tired." So he just branched into her house. And Jael said, "Toh, what do? I have an opportunity now to identify with the God of Israel and to finish this wrong alliance. I cannot be part of those who are involved in doing wrong things." And the Bible said, as the man turned in, she said to him, "Turn in, my Lord, turn in to me, fear not." When he had turned into her, into the tent, she covered him with what? With a mantle, with a rug. You know, he has been running and he's feeling cold. So what did he do? He brought blankets and put blankets on the man. And as that happened, Sisera said to her, "Give me, I beg you, a little water to drink, for I am thirsty." Jael said, "Not only water." What did she do? She opened a bottle of milk. She brought it in a lowly dish. Opened the bottle. Gave it to the man. Before the man finished, he had started snoring. By the time the man was putting his head on the ground, he said to her, "Stand in the door of the tent. It shall be when any man does come and inquire of you and say, 'Is there any man here?' tell them, 'No.'" You see what the man is teaching her to do now? To tell lies. Think it's a strategy. So Jael, Heber's wife, took a nail of the tent, a tent peg, and took an hammer in her hand and went out softly, softly, and smote the nail into his temples and fastened it into the ground, for he was fast asleep and weary, so he died. Let me talk to you about that. What does that mean? I'm seeing strategy. This woman was positioned by God to finish a battle. There are battles that are raging for 20 years over the children of Israel. And this woman was positioned to do what? To nail it to the coffin. If I tell you the physics of what she did, because what she did was very scientific. How many of you, when you put earphone here, if somebody is talking around you, do you normally hear? If somebody is sleeping by your side, who is snoring and you want to sleep, just get something like cotton wool. Put here in your ears here. Put here in your ears here. You will sleep soundly. You will not even know that he's snoring. Eh? The reason is because sand does not penetrate. If you block your temples, this is what we call the temple. That's why if you do like this, you are not hearing anything. So when a giant said, "Now this man is sleeping, how do I knock him down and he will not hear? He will not even hear the noise of the hammer until I finish what I'm doing." If you hit his leg, he will wake up because the noise will wake him. If you bang the door, he will hear, he will wake up. Let's go to where he is and let's begin the work from there. So by the time she was putting the peg on the temple. You know what she's doing? She has already blocked possibility of hearing. So while they were knocking the thing, wah, wah, he was not hearing at all. Talk less of waking up. By the time she has finished the nail to the other side of the ground, what could Sisera do? Tell me. That's how he lay down. Jege. Dead. So she came out. When she saw Barak coming, she said, come and see the man you are looking for. God has delivered your enemy into your hand. Come and pack him from here. That's how the battle finished. She did not use a gun. She only used yogurt to finish 20-year problem. Did you say women are not powerful? Eh? They can't shoot a gun, but they can serve yogurt. They can't shoot a gun, but they can give you hospitality that settles the matter. God is looking for women who, by their strategic wisdom, can end enmity in Nigeria. Whereas we describe Jahe as if she's killing a Sisera. Don't forget that she's only acting according to the word of the Lord. She only acted in the will of God for the moment. Will you be such women, man, that God can use? But now I'm dealing with Jael in two contexts. How do you deliver your husband from wrong alliance? How do you help your husband out of an alliance that is entangling him and is doing something contrary to the will of God that you know? How do you help him out? Do you say, well, I don't know what to do, I don't know what to do? How will you say you don't know what to do when God can give you divine wisdom and strategy? How will you say you don't know when the wisdom of God is available to you? We are asking God that this meeting will produce strategic women. Women that can help Nigeria to end unnecessary quarrels, one-term destructions. As we are beginning to enter into politics, can I pray that God will give us women that in their wisdom, with their lordly dishes, with their yogurts, with their little things they know how to do well, they can quench fires, they can end quarrels, they can change things in the way of God, and the Holy Spirit will take the glory. As we pray together, I call upon you this moment that heaven, there are three voices that is already crying. The voice from the city is saying, where are the mothers? The voice from the temple is saying, who will help us? And there's a noise also from heaven, God himself, he's speaking about the deliverance of this nation. And he's saying, go and look for women that can help us. There are things that brothers have that you don't have, and you don't need to struggle for it. But what you have is very critical, that if you are not there, these brothers will fall on their backs. Will you say to God, here am I, use me. Here am I. Make me an answer to the challenge of this nation at this time. Here am I. Help me. as we pray together, will you be able to say, Jesus, if I've been a woman that has not fulfilled the reason why I was born a woman, forgive me. I want to go back now to make a difference. So I say, where I'm from the village, who told you that many inter-village clash that has destroyed people? Who told you that you don't have capacity to speak peace into that place? As you join me in prayer, will you be that woman that God is looking for in Nigeria of today? Thank God that some of you came from other nations. Can you let God use you as that woman that will bring a change to that community where you are coming from? Can you say to God, whether as a teacher, whether as a nurse, whether as a trader, whether as a wife of a politician, I am born a woman to make a difference. Father, if Nigeria is to be reborn, I'm going to be the part of those who travel for it to happen. The anointing of a mother, the yearnings of a mother, the burdens of a mother, and the spirit of a mother, release it afresh upon me today. Some of you are young people, you are not married, you are spinsters, and you are saying, is it concerning me? Oh, praise God, that Jesus is reaching you before you get married, that you will step into the right place, doing the right thing. I want us to pray together. I will request you to stand on your feet with me. I'm going to present you to God, if you don't mind. If you don't mind, I'm going to say to God, here are women here. Which one of you, O God, do you want to use? Which one of them, O God, have you particularly raised at a time like this to bring a miracle to this nation? Please, Lord, help us. Let's pray together. Let's pray.
This has been Living Seed. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org, or visit our website at www.livingseed.org.